The Vows of Bodhisattva Samantabhadra Sutra. The unsurpassed, profound, and wonderful Dharma is difficult to encounter in hundreds of millions of eons. I now see and hear it, receive and uphold it, and I vow to fathom the Tathagata's true meaning. When the Bodhisattva Mahasattva Samantabhadra, having discoursed upon and eulogized the exalted merits and virtues of the Tathagata, addressed the Kumara Sudana and a great company of bodhisattvas as follows, quote, O noble-minded man, the infinite merits and virtues of the Tathagata are ineffable. If such were preached by all the Buddhas of the Ten Quarters who consecutively enumerated them during unspeakable and incalculable eons in the Buddha domains equal to the smallest dust motes in the atmosphere in number, they could not thereby be exhausted. If there be any who aspire to attain this highest state of merit, let them understand that its realization depends upon the attainment of the tenfold paramita, the vows of widest and highest aspiration, and the actual practice of them. But what is the tenfold paramita, you might ask? It is, first, to pay the highest homage and veneration to all Buddhas. Second, to preach the virtues of and to praise the glories of the Tathagatas. Third, to make abundant offerings for the veneration to the Buddhas. Fourth, to be penitent and confess one's evil deeds and hindrances. Fifth, to approve of and rejoice at the merits and virtues of others. Sixth, to request Buddhas to set in motion the wheel of the Dharma. Seventh, to beseech Buddhas to remain in the world. Eighth, to be a zealous follower of the way of the Buddhas forever. Ninth, to be always in harmony with all beings, bestowing on them gifts according to their needs. Tenth, to turn over all one's merits to benefit all beings. The Kumara Sudana said to the Bodhisattva Samantabhadra, What course shall we follow, O noble one, to fulfill all these virtues from, quote, rendering homage to Buddhas to, quote, turning over one's own merits to all beings? The Bodhisattva Samantabhadra replied to the Kumara Sudana, quote, O noble-minded man, as to what is said regarding the homage and worship of the Buddhas, it means that by the power of the virtues and vows of the Bodhisattva Samantabhadra, I, note that I means any person, have profound faith and deep understanding. As though I were face to face simultaneously with all the Buddhas of all the Buddha worlds, such Buddhas equal to the flying smallest dust motes in number throughout the worlds of the Dharma and the cosmic void of the Ten Quarters and the Three Ages. I worship and adore them constantly with my pure deeds, vis-a-vis the body, vocal, and mental deeds. Before every Buddha in the Buddha land, I present myself by miraculous transformation in unutterable and innumerable bodies, like unto the smallest specks of dust in number. With every one of my manifestations, I pay homage to all the Buddhas of every Buddha domain, and such Buddhas are equal to the smallest dust motes in number. My homage will be ended when the limitation of the infinite space is ended. As the space is boundless, so also is my homage to the Buddhas without end. So it is when the spheres of beings are ended, the karmas of beings are ended, the sorrows of beings are ended. These too are endless. Even so is my homage to all the Buddhas endless. Thought following upon thought, without interruption, and in bodily, vocal, and mental deeds, without weariness. Again, O noble-minded man, what signifies, quote, to preach the virtues of and to praise the glories of the Tathagatas? It means that in the smallest dust motes of all the worlds of the ten quarters and the three ages throughout the Dharma circles and the cosmic void, upon each speck of dust where the Buddhas are dwelling, equal in number to the smallest specks of dust in all the worlds, and each Buddha is surrounded by an assembly of bodhisattvas as wide as the ocean, I shall apply my profound insight and my temporal knowledge to fathom them till I thoroughly understand. Then will I praise them with my oration, as though it were with the angelic and eloquent tongues of the goddess Sarasvati, each tongue emitting a boundless ocean of all forms of sound, each voice emitting a boundless ocean of all forms of speech, proclaiming the ocean of the merits of all Tathagatas. Such praises shall continue without cessation through endless time and the limitless realms of the Dharma worlds. My praises will cease when the void of space is ended, or the spheres of beings are ended, or the karmas of beings are ended, or the sorrows of beings are ended. But all the things from the space of the void, even to the sorrows of beings, are endless. So also are my praises endless. Thought succeeding thought, without interruption, and in bodily, vocal, and mental deeds, without weariness. Again, O noble-minded man, what is meant by abundant offerings out of veneration to the Buddhas? It means that in the smallest dust motes of the Buddha domains of the Dharma circles and of the cosmic void and of the ten quarters and three yugas, in each speck of dust exist the Buddhas, equal in number to the smallest dust motes of all worlds. Each Buddha is surrounded by an ocean-wide assembly of bodhisattvas, in whom I have profound faith and reverent understanding through the power of the vows of the Bodhisattva Samantabhadra. I would offer them the most rare and wondrous gifts, such as the flowery clouds, garland clouds, heavenly music clouds, celestial tapestry clouds, angelic garment clouds, all kinds of heavenly perfumes, scented balms, aromatic incenses, aromatic powders with equal in quality to Mount Sumeru, the king of mountains. I would present lighted lamps of various kinds, such as the cream lamps, the oil lamps, and the lamps of sweet perfumes, the wick of each lamp being in size as Mount Sumeru, the king of the mountains, and the burning oil of each as great as the water of the ocean. Ceaselessly would I offer such gifts in veneration. O noble-minded man, among all gifts, the crown of them are the gifts of the Dharma. Such gifts are called the offering of, quote, following the instructions of all the Buddhas, the offering of benefit for all beings, the offering of embracing and sustaining all beings, the offering of taking upon oneself the suffering of others, the offering of fostering the root of merit diligently, the offering of swerving not from the bodhisattva vows, and the offering of departing not from the love of the bodhi heart. O noble-minded man, truly the merit to be derived from the offering of material gifts such as those enumerated are infinite. Yet, in comparison with a single thought of Dharma, they are as nothing. Those merits derived from material offerings would not be equal to 100th part of the merit of a thought of Dharma, nay, not to 100,000th part of Kotis, of Nayutas, of Kalans, and of Upanishads. And why? Because the Dharma is held in the highest esteem by all the Tathagatas. Moreover, all the Buddhas are begotten from the Dharma through the perfecting of their conduct in accordance with it. If the Bodhisattvas make offerings to the Dharma to the Buddhas, then their offerings to the Tathagatas are completed. Thus do the Bodhisattvas present the truest offering of gifts to the Tathagatas. My offering of such great and noble gifts to Buddhas will cease if the cosmic void of space is ended, or the spheres of beings are ended, or the karmas of beings are ended, or the sorrows of beings are ended. But as all the things from the space of the void to the sorrows of all beings are endless, so also will my offering to Buddhas be endless. Thought succeeding thought without interruption, in bodily, vocal, and mental deeds without weariness. Again, O noble-minded man, what is meant by being penitent and confessing one's evil deeds and hindrances? A bodhisattva would think thus: all the evil deeds I have committed hitherto during the kalpas without beginning of the past, caused by the emotion of lust, hatred, and stupidity, leading to bodily, speech, and mental actions, are boundless. If such deeds were corporeal and in forms, all the cosmic spaces, unlimited as it is, could not contain them. I now confess and repent them all by my three purified deeds, and with a sincere heart, pledging myself not to commit an evil deed hereafter. I will always keep myself pure in the prohibitive precepts and in all active moral deeds. I will lay this penance before all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas of all worlds and Dharma circles, equal in number to the smallest dust motes. My penance will cease when the void of space is ended, or the spheres of beings are ended, or the karmas of beings are ended, or the sorrows of beings are all ended. But as all the things from the void of space to the sorrows of beings are endless, so also is my penitence endless. Thought succeeding thought without interruption, in bodily, vocal, and mental deeds, without weariness. Again, O noble-minded man, what is meant by, quote, approving of and rejoicing at the merits and virtues of others? In Buddha lands, the Buddhas equal in number to the smallest dust motes of all the worlds, throughout all the Dharma circles and cosmic void of the 10 quarters, and in the duration of the 3 yugas, have devoted their lives to the sole purpose of acquiring all wisdom and diligently accumulating merit. Since they began to direct their minds toward Bodhi, throughout the duration of unutterable and innumerable kalpas and in Buddha domains, equal in number to the smallest dust motes of all worlds, during each kalpa, having sacrificed their heads, eyes, hands, and feet in unutterable and incalculable numbers as the smallest dust motes of Buddha spheres, having thus overcome all difficulties and accomplished all the arduous tasks, perfected the various stages of paramita, passing through the experiences of the bodhisattva wisdom, and accomplished the highest bodhi of Buddhas, till entered into parinirvana, whereupon they distributed the sariras. All such good roots of merit I emulate and rejoice in. Moreover, whatever merit or virtue may be possessed by any being, either of the 6 divisions of existence, or belonging to the 4 kinds of birth, or appertaining to any species of life in the worlds of the 10 quarters, though such merit may be as infinitesimal as a grain of dust, all will have my sympathy and corresponding regard. With all such, I rejoice. Again, all the Sravakas, the Pratyeka Buddhas, the thoroughly learned ones, and those who are still to be advanced on the path of disciples, all such are the saints of the 10 quarters and the 3 generations, with whom I rejoice in their merit, if any may be possessed. All the Bodhisattvas, who through infinite self-sacrifice and boundless achievement have overcome all obstacles, and having formed the wish to attain the highest goal of Bodhi, with them also I rejoice in their vast merits. Thus, even though the void of space, together with the states of being, with the karmas of beings, with the sorrows of beings, though all these be ended, yet my approval and joy in the merits of all beings will not be ended. Thought succeeding thought, without interruption, in bodily, vocal, and mental deeds, without weariness. Again, O noble-minded man, what is meant by beseeching the Buddhas to set in motion the, quote, wheel of Dharma? It means that I will apply my body, speech, and mental efforts and various expedient means and the most skillful methods earnestly to request the Buddhas to rotate the wondrous wheel of Dharma. Such Buddhas are incalculable in number as the smallest flying dust motes of the Buddha domains of the Ten Quarters and the Three Yugas throughout the Dharma realms and the cosmic void. Each dust mote respectfully contains therein unutterable and innumerable vast Buddha lands, equal in number to the smallest dust motes. In each country dwell ineffable and innumerable Buddhas equal to the smallest dust motes in number. In each moment there are Buddhas equal to the smallest dust motes in number who are attaining enlightenment, and each is surrounded by an ocean-wide assembly of bodhisattvas. I constantly request such Buddhas to turn the wheel of right Dharma. Thus, even though the space of the void has ended, and likewise the world of beings, the karmas of beings, and the sorrows of beings all have ended, yet my request is endless. Thought succeeding thought, without interruption, and in bodily, vocal, and mental deeds, without weariness. Again, O noble-minded man, what is meant by, quote, beseeching the Buddhas to remain in the world? The Buddhas are infinite in number as the minutest dust motes of the Ten Quarters and three generations throughout the Dharma realms and cosmic void. And so are the Bodhisattvas, the Shravakas, the Pratyeka Buddhas, the wholly learned ones, the partly learned ones, and the well-learned laymen. When they set their minds on the attainment of Nirvana, I entreat them all to remain in touch with mankind instead of entering Nirvana. Even to the duration of Kalpas of Buddha lands, equal in the minutest dust motes in number, in order to benefit all living beings. Thus, even though the cosmic void has ended, and likewise the states of beings, the karmas of beings, and the sorrows of beings, though all such have an end, yet my petition to the Buddhas is endless. Thought succeeds thought, without interruption, and in bodily, speech, and mental deeds, without weariness. Again, O noble-minded man, what is meant by being, quote, under Buddha's guidance forever? It means, for instance, the Tathagatavairocana of the Saha world, who from the beginning, when he made an earnest wish for obtaining Buddhahood in order to deliver all beings, and having made the exquisite advance by unremittingly skillful exertion and sacrificed his lives and bodies in unutterable and countless number for the sake of almsgiving, he stripped off his own skin for parchment, used his own blood for ink, and his bones for writing instruments. Thus the scripture had been written in bulk, as great as Mount Sumeru. In appreciation of the Dharma, he would disregard the royal throne, dominions, palaces, gardens, and all that appertained to him. He spared no energy in his arduous career and painstaking until he accomplished the great Bodhi under the tree. Then he displayed various exalted powers, manifested various transmutations, revealed various Buddha figures, and presided at the various assemblies, such as the assemblies of great bodhisattvas, the assemblies of Sravakas and Pratyeka Buddhas, the assemblies of the Takravardi Raja and petty kings and their retinues, the assemblies of Kshatriya, Brahmins, elders and laymen, the assemblies of Devas, Nagas, eight groups, mankind and subhuman. At these assemblies and sanctuaries, he spoke in a full and round voice of thunder, with expedient means and skillful methods, teaching the beings in a manner befitting their inclinations and happiness. Thus he led them to the maturity of Bodhi until he entered Nirvana. All these examples I will follow, not only that of the present world-honored one, Vairocana, but of all the Tathagatas of the Buddha countries, equal in number to the dust motes of the 10 quarters and 3 yugas, throughout the Dharma realms and cosmic void. I will follow the examples of the Buddhas from thought to thought, even though the void of space has ended, and the worlds of beings, the karmas of beings, the sorrows of beings, all have ended, yet my practice and following of the examples of the Buddhas will not be ended. Thought succeeds thought without interruption, and in bodily, vocal, and mental deeds without weariness. Again, O noble-minded man, what is meant by, quote, always in compliance with beings? It means always in harmony with the beings of the worlds of the 10 quarters, throughout the Dharma circles and cosmic void. They are known as the beings to be born from the womb, from the egg, from moisture, and produced by metamorphosis. They live in different elements, either abiding on the earth, in the water, in the fire that is heat, or in the wind. There are also some beings flying in the void, preaching in forests and bushes. They are of various species, forms, lineaments, colors, length of life, appellations, natures, knowledge, habits, characteristics, manners, costumes, and diets. They dwell in innumerable abiding places, in towns, villages, cities, and palaces. They comprise the devas, the nagas, the 8 groups, human beings, subhumans. Some have no feet, some 2 feet, some 4 feet, and others have many feet. Some are with form, some without form, with sense, without sense, or neither with nor without sense. All of these should be accommodated and served by me according to their needs and their natures, as attentively as I would show filial respect to my parents, due respect to my teachers, to elders and arhats, up to the Tathagatas, all in equality. I would be a good physician to the sick, a guide to those who have wandered from the path, setting their feet on the right way. I would be a light to those who wander in darkness. I would enable the people in poverty to discover the vaults of treasure. A bodhisattva should thus benefit all beings with equal treatment and bestow his loving care on all beings alike. And why? Because if a bodhisattva serves all beings, that is equal to serving the Buddhas dutifully. To hold all beings in high esteem and render them respectful services, that is equal to reverencing and serving the Tathagatas. To make all beings happy is to please all Tathagatas. And why? Because the great compassionate heart is the essence of Buddhahood. For the sake of delivering all beings, the Bodhisattva develops great compassion, and from the great compassion springs the Bodhi heart, and from the Bodhi heart comes the enlightenment. This is like unto the king of mighty trees growing in the wilderness and barren desert. If it gets no water, it wilts and dies, but if its roots be well watered, we shall see it flourishing with full foliage, blossoming in its full effulgence, and bearing plentiful fruit. A king Bodhi tree is even thus. All beings are roots of the Bodhi tree. The Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas are its fruits and flowers. If Bodhisattvas apply the water of great compassion to all beings who form its roots, the Bodhi tree will bloom with flowers and bear the fruits of the wisdom of Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. And why? If bodhisattvas apply the nectar of great compassion to benefit all beings, they will attain the Anuttara Samyak Sambodhi. Therefore, the beings are essential to the Bodhi, for without them, there are no bodhisattvas able to attain the supreme transcendental wisdom. Ponder, O noble-minded man, on the truth in this parable. Look upon all beings with impartial mind and equality. Thus will the great compassion be brought to the state of fullness and completion. To bestow the great compassion upon all beings, that is equal to serving the Tathagatas to their satisfaction. My compassionate embrace of all beings shall never cease. Even though the space of the void has ended, the worlds of beings, the karmas of beings, and the sorrows of beings are all ended, yet my boundless compassion is endless, and in bodily, vocal, and mental deeds, without weariness. Again, O noble-minded man, what signifies, quote, turning over all one's merits to benefit all sentient beings? This means that all one's merits acquired from the commencement of paying the highest homage to all the Buddhas and serving the needs of all beings shall be transferred to all beings throughout the Dharma worlds and immeasurable spaces of the universe, wishing them to be happy and free from affliction or illness. All their evil projects will fail, and all their virtuous intentions will be quickly achieved. Close the door against evil, and open the right path of nirvana to men and devas. If the beings are suffering the most terrible tortures in expiation of their accumulated evil doings, I will substitute myself and take upon myself the sufferings that their evil deeds have brought upon them. So shall they be released from evil deeds and finally attain the supreme Bodhi. Thus do all the bodhisattvas devote themselves to the cultivation of virtue and merit and turn the rewards over to the benefit of all beings. My loving embrace of all beings is eternal. Even though the void of space has ended, or the worlds of beings, or the karmas of beings, or the sorrows of beings have all ended, yet my compassion for all beings, by turning over my rewards of merit to them, is endless. Thought succeeds thought, without interruption, and in bodily, vocal, and mental deeds, without weariness. O noble-minded man, such is the tenfold great vow of all bodhisattvas and mahasattvas in completion. The bodhisattvas who achieve the performance of these vows will lead all beings to the fruition of Bodhi and attainment of Anuttara Samyak Sambodhi. He, whomsoever is a bodhisattva, can fulfill the ocean of vows of bodhisattva Samantabhadra. Therefore, O noble-minded man, thou shouldest comprehend the truth and attain thereto. If a noble-minded man or woman, fill the incalculable Buddha spheres in unutterable and innumerable number, equal to the dust motes of the 10 quarters, with the 7 exquisite gems, and with the highest joys of men and devas, offer all as gifts to the beings of all worlds, and offered the same in adoration to the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas of all worlds, and continued such offerings for a period of kalpas of Buddha countries equal to the dust motes of the universe in number, and so produced great stores of merit, yet such an offering would be infinitesimal in comparison with the merit acquired by one who has only listened to the very King of Vows. The measure of the stock of merit of the former one would not equal 1/100th part of the latter, nay, not 1/1000th part, even not to an upanishadth part of the merit of the latter. Again, whosoever has profound faith in this great vow and will accept, recite, or write even one gatha of 4 lines only, such will quickly expiate the 5 deadly sins and all physical illness or mental anguish and afflictions of the mundane world, even his sinful deeds equal to the dust motes of all Buddha lands in number, will be blotted out. All malignant forces, Yakas, Rakshasas, Kumbandas, Visakas, Bhutas, bloodsuckers, and cannibals, all such evil spirits will keep afar from him, or even willingly protect him, by acting as his tutelary gods. Therefore, he who recites these vows will have no obstacles to impede his progress, wherever he goes in the world, as the moon comes out from the hazy clouds. Praised by Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, he will be honored by men and devas, and adored by all beings. This noble-minded man is well incarnated in a human body and has brought to perfection all the merits and virtues of Bodhisattva Samantabhadra. He will soon become like the Bodhisattva Samantabhadra, with a glorious body of bliss, resplendent with the 32 attributes of a hero. If he be born in the Deva or human worlds, such a one will always be born into most noble class, and he will destroy all evil influences and keep away from wicked friends. He will be free from all passions. He will conquer the men of wrong doctrines. He will be like unto the king of lions, able to subdue all animals. He deserves to receive gifts from all beings. Again, when such a person comes to die, and at the last kasana approaches death, all his sense organs perish, all kinsmen and relatives are abandoned, all influences are lost, his state ministers and courtiers are departed, trappings of the inner or outer palaces, elephants and horses, carriages, jewels and the treasure repositories, all such are left behind. However, the king of vows will be his sole companion, and will forsake him not, but at all times will go before him and lead him to Sukhavati, the world of highest happiness, the land of Buddha Amitabha. In a kasana, having already reached that Buddha land and been reborn there, upon his arrival he sees the Buddha Amitabha, surrounded by the Bodhisattvas Manjushri, Samantabhadra, Avalokitesvara, Maitreya, and others. These are of magnificent form and noble appearance, and are perfected with all virtues and merits. While the man finds himself born from the lotus flower and favored by the Buddha with the prediction of attaining Buddhahood in the future, after having received the Vaikarana, he will pour out the power of his wisdom to benefit all beings according to their faith or the strength of their mind. Such deeds shall be performed throughout the 10 quarters of infinite and innumerable worlds. Soon he will be sitting in the Bodhi Mandala, quelling the forces of Mara, attaining enlightenment, and rotating the wondrous wheel of Dharma. So will he enable the innumerable worlds of Buddha lands, in number as infinitesimal dust motes, to direct their minds toward the attainment of Bodhi according to their ability and nature, being brought to maturity thereby. And so he will continue doing such things throughout coming kalpas, and thus widely benefit all beings. O noble-minded man, whosoever of the multitude has awakened faith on hearing this great king of vows, observes, reads, recites, and widely preaches it to others, the merits produced thereby none but the Buddha can estimate. Therefore, you should allow no doubts to cloud your minds on hearing this king of vows, but carefully accept, read, recite, and put the teaching into actual practice and publish it to others. Such persons will attain to the fulfillment of this vow by a single thought, and their accumulation of bliss acquired therefrom is boundless. It can deliver all beings from the great ocean of pain and sorrow, and ensure their rebirth in the paradise of Buddha Amitabha. Thereupon, the Bodhisattva Mahasattva Samantabhadra in confirmation of this truth, turning around to the ten quarters, uttered the following stanzas. 1. I worship all the lions among men of the worlds of the ten quarters and three yugas. With my pure body, speech, and mind, I do homage to them all, without exception. 2. By the divine power of the merits and vows of Bodhisattva Samantabhadra, I manifest myself before all Tathagatas. From my original body emanate innumerable bodies, and with each of my bodies I do homage to the innumerable bodies, and with each of my bodies I do homage to the innumerable Buddhas simultaneously. 3. I deeply believe that in a grain of dust there exist countless Buddhas and assemblies of Bodhisattvas. Likewise, that the dust in boundless circles of the Dharma are filled with Buddhas. 4. Emitting from the ocean-like infinity all voices with the wondrous speeches, I praise the profound merits and virtues of Buddhas, and continue to do so through all eons in the future. 5. I present Tathagatas with the best gifts of flowery canopies, banners, garlands, fragrant ointments, and music. 6. Again, I offer to Tathagatas the best garments, incenses, lamps, and candles in an assemblage as high as Mount Sumeru. 7. Through my wise understanding and high inspiration, I have profound faith in all Buddhas of the three yugas. By the power of the merits and vows of Bodhisattva Samantabhadra, I adore and serve all Tathagatas without omission. 8. The various wickednesses I committed in the past are derived from time without beginning, and through avarice, hatred, and from infatuation of bodily actions, speech, and thoughts, I now repent and abstain from them all. 9. Any merit or virtue of all Tathagatas or the Bodhisattvas, the thoroughly learned ones and the partly learned one of the two vehicles, even of the ordinary beings of the ten quarters, I approve all and am pleased with. 10. Those pioneers of Bodhi and the brilliant ones who are to be likened unto a lamp illuminating the worlds of the ten quarters and the three yugas, I request them to turn the wondrous wheel of the Dharma. 11. When the Buddha set their minds on the attainment of Nirvana, I earnestly entreat them to remain in the worlds for the duration of boundless kalpas in order to benefit and delight all beings. 12. All the treasures of merit and roots of goodness produced from the tenfold aspiration of Samantabhadra, I shall turn over to all beings in their favor and in Buddhahood. 13. I follow the ways of the Tathagatas and elaborate the merits of Bodhisattva Samantabhadra in completion, making offerings out of veneration for the Tathagatas in the ten quarters and of the three generations. 14. I desire to carry out the principles of the teachers of devas and men to their satisfaction, and I train myself by studying their teachings and quickly reach the goal of great Bodhi. 15. The Buddha countries of the ten quarters are vast, pure, and magnificent. There, the Tathagatas are surrounded by various assemblies. Respectfully under each Bodhi tree, the king of trees. 16. I wish that the beings in the ten quarters may be free from passions and afflictions and be always happy. May they acquire the deep profit of the right Dharma. May they tear out the passions, even to the very root. 17. When I strove for the attainment of Bodhi, I was able to gain the supernormal powers of remembering previous lives and karmas in all worlds wheresoever I was born, and during each of my pre-existences I attained the same knowledge. Always I joined the order observe the pure precept strictly, without stain or leakage. 18. There are devas, nagas, yakas, gumbandas, men and subhumans, etc., to whom I preach the law by using various voices befitted to their native languages. 19. Diligently cultivating the pure paramitas, I forget not the Bodhi heart. Annihilating hindrances and defilements without exception, I achieved all the marvelous merits. 20. I am able to free myself from worldly life and the environment of Maras, just as the lotus flower shoots up from the water, but it is not wetted thereby, and as the sun and moon appear in the void, but abide not in it. 21. I relieve the distress of the beings of all evil realms and equally bestow happiness on them. I continue to do so throughout the lapse of boundless kalpas and in the extent of the 10 quarters of the universe. The benefits for all are eternal and omnipresent. 22. I will always be harmonious to the beings and render them aid, and will continue such doings throughout all coming kalpas. And I will cherish the great merits of Samantabhadra and perfect the supreme great Bodhi thereby. 23. All my fellow devotees shall be gathered together from all parts. Our bodily speech, mental deeds are equivalent to one another. We study the same doctrine and vows together. 24. Any well-learned man who shows me the practice of the vows of Samantabhadra thus benefits me. I wish always to be in his company. May he be pleased with me. 25. I desire to see the Tathagatas often, and also their retinue, the sons of Jina. I will make vast offerings of veneration to them in all coming kalpas without cessation or indolence. 26. I desire to magnify and expand all the activities of Bodhi by applying the wondrous Dharma of Buddhas, perfecting the pure doctrine of Samantabhadra by studying and practicing it throughout all the coming kalpas. 27. Among all the beings, I will cultivate merits and wisdom boundlessly. Thereby, I will gain a never-exhausting store of samadhi, prajna, upaya, and multi-moksha. 28. A single grain of dust contains therein the incalculable countries. In each country dwell incalculable Buddhas. Each Buddha is surrounded by many assemblies. I see them constantly performing the practice of Bodhi. 29. Throughout the ocean-like system of worlds and the ocean-like gatherings of the Buddhas of the 10 quarters, whereof each hair point appears as an ocean-like system of the 3 yugas, I will cultivate my merit by passing through all these oceans and continue to do so for the period of an ocean of kalpas. 30. The speeches of all Tathagatas are pure and clear. Each word comprises the ocean of all voices, and respectively swelling the ocean of the orations of Buddhas. In order to preach the Dharma for the beings according to their understandings and pleasure, the various forms of speech are applied. 31. All the Tathagatas of the 3 ages possess the ocean of everlasting speech and constantly rotate the wheel of the wonderful meaning of truth. Such I thoroughly fathomed by my profound wisdom. 32. I can clearly behold the state of the future, and I combine all coming kalpas into a single thought. I penetrate all the kalpas of the 3 ages thoroughly in a mental flash of vision. 33. I can foresee the three ages by one thought. Those who are called lion among men also can enter the Buddha state, as it were in a phantasm or vision, and that power enables them to reach the stage of emancipation. 34. From the smallest breath, as that of the point of a hair, come forth the magnificent and holy countries of the three yugas. I penetrate deeply all the innumerable, magnificent, and pure countries of the hair points of the ten quarters. 35. I come into contact with those who shall be the light of the world in the future, who will be enlightened and will turn the wheel of the Dharma to awaken all beings. They will enter into Nirvana after having perfected their Buddha works. With all of these, I will be friendly. 36. May I possess the following powers: the power of Abhijna, which goes over every part of the world with supernormal speed; the power of Mahayana, which penetrates the universal gate of all directions; the power of merits and virtues, which is wisely and widely cultivated; and power of great compassion, which shelters all who come for that refuge through the divinity and grace of the Buddhas. 37. Again, the power of blessing dignifies and purifies every part of the world. The power of wisdom is independent, is attached to nothing, and abides nowhere. The power of concentrated immobility of meditation or samadhi, wisdom or prajna, and expedient means or upaya are endowed with supernormal might. The power of bodhi is in the positive and accumulative nature throughout every part. 38. Also, the power of purity refines all meritorious deeds. The power of destruction destroys all passions or kleshas. The power of conquest subdues all maras. The power of fulfillment perfects the merits of Samantabhadra. 39. I wish to extend my power in the following directions. May I be able to purify and embellish the ocean of all the worlds. May I emancipate all beings from the ocean of life and death. May I be able to discern the ocean of various dharmas. May I be able to enter deeply into the ocean of wisdom. 40. Also, may I be able to purify the ocean of all conduct. May I fulfill the ocean of all wishes and perfection. May I be in close touch with and serve the ocean of Buddhas. I shall cultivate and cherish the principle without weariness through the duration of an ocean of kalpas. 41. All the Tathagatas of the three yugas have their exalted activities and vows of bodhi, which I fully practice in their adoration as my offerings. I shall be enlightened by the conduct of Samantabhadra. 42. All the Tathagatas have their eldest son of the Dharma, whose name is Samantabhadra. I now turn all my good roots toward the attainment of wisdom and behavior. May I be tantamount to the Bodhisattva Samantabhadra in all his qualities. 43. I wish that my body, speech, and thoughts always be pure, and that the behavior of others of the various worlds may be the same. Whosoever possesses such wisdom is entitled, quote, Samantabhadra. I wish that I shall be equivalent to him in every quality. 44. For the purpose of purifying all my virtues of Samantabhadra and the great vows of Manjushri, may I fulfill all those duties to the utmost without any omission. May I continue my task through the coming kalpas without weariness. 45. my cultivation of merit is boundless. Therefore, have I acquired boundless good deeds. I abide myself in the boundless virtues and attained the high understanding of all supernormal powers. 46. I now turn over my accumulated virtues toward the attainment of the brave or sharp advance of Manjushri and the wise conduct of Samantabhadra. May I follow the ways of them and study ceaselessly. 47. I now devote my merits on the expectation of gaining the most excellent conduct of Samantabhadra. Such great vows will be praised by the Buddhas of the three generations. 48. I wish that at the approach of death, I may annihilate all hindrances. Thus, I may be able to see the Buddha Amitabha face to face, so that with his aid, I may go and be reborn in his peaceful and happy world. 49. Upon my rebirth in that world, I shall actually fulfill my great aim, realize my every wish without any omission, and offer the benefits and happiness to all beings. 50. The members of the assembly of that Buddha are pure and holy. Even so am I, springing into existence by apparitional birth from the pure and holy flower of the lotus, and seeing face to face the Tathagata of infinite splendor. In his presence, I shall receive assurance of my destiny to attain Bodhi, namely, Vayakarana. That is, the Buddha announces that so-and-so will become a Buddha at such and such a time. 51. When I have been favored by that Tathagata with the prediction, then I reveal myself by transformation into incalculable bodies of myriads of kotis in number, being possessed of great power and wisdom, extending over the 10 quarters, in order to benefit the various beings in all the worlds. 52. When the infinitude of the universe comes to an end, beings and their karmas and passions all are ended. Nevertheless, my vows of aspiration are ultimately and solely endless. 53. He who offers the precious gifts, produced from the boundless countries of the 10 quarters, in honor of Tathagatas, and offers the best enjoyments to the devas and human beings for a duration of kalpas equal in number to the finest atoms of dust composing all the worlds, make merits beyond computation. 54. On the other hand, he who, upon hearing of this king of unique vows, and thus being awakened to faith with the intention of seeking the wonderful Bodhi in fervent aspiration, will acquire merits in consequence thereof which are still greater than the former one. 55. Thus, he will keep afar from wicked advisors, and never sink into any of the evil realms. Moreover, he will soon see the Tathagata of infinite light. These are all the results of the wonderful vows of Samantabhadra. 56. Such a person will easily be born in the human world and enjoy an excellent life of longevity. He will soon attain the bodhisattvahood of Samantabhadra. 57. In past times, owing to the lack of wisdom, I have committed the most wicked 5 deadly sins. These will be expiated in a moment of thought by reciting this great king of vows of Samantabhadra. 58. If he wishes to be born in the human or deva worlds, he is certain to be a member of the highest race, perfecting with noble lineages and wisdom. No enemies of other religions or Maras can subdue him. Moreover, he is worthy to be adored by the triple worlds. 59. Hasten to the king of great trees, the tree of Bodhi. Sitting there, subdue the Maras. Attain enlightenment and turn the wheel of Dharma, in order to benefit all sentient beings. 60. If there be anyone who observes, recites, and preaches the vows of Samantabhadra, the result thereof none is able to estimate except the Buddhas. He infallibly will attain the supremacy of Bodhi. 61. Whosoever recites the vows of Samantabhadra, I affirm that, having planted good roots, at least they will bring every quality of Dharma into completion by a single thought, and finally will be able to deliver the beings so as to fulfill his pure vows. 62. My practice of the unique vows of Samantabhadra, from which boundless and marvelous blessedness is produced, are all to be turned over to the beings who are deeply sunken into the sea of pain and sorrows, or of birth and death. Wishing them all to be delivered, I pray that they may soon attain to the country of the Buddha of infinite splendor. When the Bodhisattva Mahasattva Samantabhadra had concluded his great oration on the great King of Vows and had recited the Purugathas before the Tathagata, the Kumara Sudana was overwhelmed with joy, and all the Bodhisattvas enraptured with ecstasy. The Tathagata applauded, "Excellent, excellent." At the assembly where this inconceivable state of emancipation and exalted Dharma was proclaimed, there were present the world-honored one and a great company of the saints, Bodhisattvas and Mahasattvas, with the Bodhisattva Manjushri at the head of the assembly. The great Bodhisattvas, with their fully trained 6,000 bhikshus, were led by the Bodhisattvas Maitreya. All the great Bodhisattvas of the Bhadrakalpa were led by Bodhisattva Vimala Samantabhadra. The Ekajati Pratyeka Buddhas, who are in the stage of Murdhati Jikata, and the great Bodhisattvas and others of the 10 quarters of the various worlds, all were present in this congregation. Great and exalted beings of the ocean of worlds, equal in number to the smallest dust motes of all the worlds, all these were led by the great wise one Sariputra, and by the Mahamogalyayana. There were present also great Shravakas, Devas, rulers of the worlds, the Nagas, the Yakas, Gandharvas, Asuras, Garudas, Kinaras, and Maharagas, human and subhuman. And the whole multitude, on hearing the discourse of the Buddha, were inspired with great joy to faithful observance of the vows. Here ends the vows of Samantabhadra. First, to pay the highest homage and veneration to all Buddhas. Second, to preach the virtues of and to praise the glories of the Tathagatas. Third, to make abundant offerings for the veneration to the Buddhas. Fourth, to be penitent and confess one's evil deeds and hindrances. Fifth, to approve of and rejoice at the merits and virtues of others. Sixth, to request Buddhas to set in motion the wheel of the Dharma. Seventh, to beseech Buddhas to remain in the world. Eighth, to be a zealous follower of the way of the Buddhas forever. Ninth, to be always in harmony with all beings, bestowing on them gifts according to their needs. 10th, to turn over all one's merits to benefit all beings.